Hello, I'm Bill Glover, President of the American Psychoanalytic Association. Welcome to Todd Essig's video presentation on emergency conversion to tele-treatment, making it work. Todd Essig is a doctor in psychology, a training and supervising psychoanalyst at the William Allenson White Institute in New York. Todd is well known as a pioneer in the innovative uses of mental health technologies, and he publishes and lectures widely. Todd has served on editorial boards for Contemporary Psychoanalysis and for JAPA, and recently co-edited a special issue of Psychoanalytic Perspectives on Psychoanalysis and Technology. He also has recently helped create the Section 10 on Psychoanalysis and Technology of Division 39 of the American Psychological Association. And he serves as an advisor to the steering committee of the Psychotherapy Action Network. In the aftermath of 9/11, Todd was board chair for the New York Disaster Counseling Coalition, providing free mental health care to first responders and their families. Recently, he was named co-chair of APSA's COVID-19 advisory team. Todd also writes Managing Mental Wealth for Forbes magazine, where he covers the intersection of technology, psychology, and culture. His practice is now all online. Previously, it was in New York City, where he treated individuals and couples, almost all of whom came to his office. You'll find Todd is very knowledgeable and engaging. Please enjoy the presentation. I think you'll find it very helpful.
Hi, and welcome. I'm Todd Essig. I want to thank Bill for that introduction and also thank him for everything he's been doing to help the psychoanalytic community during this time of COVID-19. My office is actually in downtown New York City, or at least it was until I was forced to become a full-time telehealth provider. Being downtown 19 years ago, I was very involved in 9/11 relief work and learned a fundamental truth about disaster mental health, something I think is quite valuable. When you're feeling helpless, the best thing you can do is help someone. So, thanks for taking the time to watch this video. I hope it helps. I know making it has helped me. Something else I know is that by pulling together, by sharing experiences, expertise, and support, we'll find a way to pull through this time of trauma and loss, because we really are all in this together. What you're about to watch is a recorded version of a workshop I presented last week to the faculty and candidates at the Emory University Psychoanalytic Institute after an invite from their director, Stephanie Spienberg. That workshop was itself a version of a workshop I've been teaching about remote treatment and shared embodiment, but one adapted to the unique demands of our rapid forced transition to full telehealth practices. What you're about to see is an ever so slightly more refined version, at least that was my intention, I hope it's a bit more refined, of what I presented at Emory. As I'm sure you've already noticed, the production values are a lot suboptimal. We decided it's important not to let the optimal be the enemy of the good enough, which is also the theme of what you're about to see. You know, although it may feel like it's been a lifetime, we're still at the very beginning of this, and we wanted to get this out there while people are still transitioning to all online work and learning how to make it work for them and their practices. I hope it's going to help us think together about how to do what we're being forced to do, to think together about how to make it work whatever the duration of this crisis happens to be, and even think together about that hoped-for day when we return to our offices and classrooms. Because the reality is this situation is completely unique and traumatic for everyone. So no one really knows what's best. The best we can do is think together about how to be of help. Let's get started. Okay, well, here's a bird's eye view of what I hope to accomplish with this presentation. As you'll see, it starts with the most general and ends with the most specific and personal. The most general is the overall clinical context that we have to make telehealth work in the midst of a global pandemic. Next, we move to trying to understand how the primary tool for telehealth, for teleanalysis and teletherapy, that is, conducting a relationship at a distance, how that actually works and what makes it different from what happens in the office. Then we'll turn to specifically to support for a clinical sensibility that is at the core of what I think we are all trying to do, which is trying to make it work. Finally, and most specifically, we'll try to ground everything before we stop in hope, values, and the kind of clinician one wants to be. Let me make a quick techno-practical suggestion. You know, what you're about to watch and listen to, it's kind of a podcast with slides. You don't have to watch the whole thing all at once. Feel free to watch it in sections, since these four sections provide easy breaks or pretty much any time you want to take a break. Just hit the pause button whenever you like. And I promise I won't be offended if you pause and walk away to do something else. Just be sure to come back. Okay, let's try to contextualize the move to remote treatment, supervision, and classes. Because it's a pandemic, it's not a choice. If ever there was a time when external events were present in our work, inside our relationship, our minds, and our unconscious, it's now. Simply stated, this is a pandemic. It's not a time-specific trauma like 9/11 or a disaster like a tsunami, but it is a traumatic event slowly unfolding over weeks and months. This is a graph prepared by COVID-19 advisory team member Jeffrey Taxman that provides a representation for how communities respond to disasters over time. While it comes from his work with discrete events like a tsunami, it can be usefully applied to what we're going through. For those of us who provide psychoanalysis and psychotherapy, the impact can be thought of as taking place when we were forced to become telehealth providers, or maybe otherwise became aware of the still unbounded magnitude of this traumatic event. We are somewhere here, in the heroic phase of all coming together. Right now, we're coming together, we're getting hearts and exclamation points, people are saying thank you, staying home to binge Netflix. This is starting to get attenuated. In my experience, people are starting to get a little tired of this because that moves to where we are going. Because as the difficulties continue to mount for ourselves and our patients, we will soon be sliding into disillusionment pending the eventual resolution to the crisis. Yes, this will end. So as we try to adapt to practicing with screens and speakers rather than chairs and couches, we should also be mindful of when we and our patients return to the office. When we need to reestablish trust, when we need to recreate an office that is a psychologically safe space, rather than a potential infection site to be avoided. When teaching, supervising, and treating online might actually be a triggering event for traumatic and distressing memories. We don't know what's going to happen, but it's going to be difficult. This graph represents both the start and the end of today's unique clinical context. And while we're here, still near the beginning, it's important to keep the end in mind. And between now and then, and at the risk of moving too rapidly from the heroic honeymoon to a disillusioning reality, hopefully, I hope, a very, very few of us, if any, will be lost. Unfortunately, that hope takes a very different form for all those health professionals on the front lines of taking care of people suffering from this viral infection. Now, our challenges are obviously different, yet it's still similar in that we have to make it work despite the traumatic moment in which we find ourselves. Plus, we also face a risk, albeit a very different one. In our telehealth clinical context, we are as protected from the virus as physical distancing, quarantine, hand washing, masks, and the like allows. But we are in the epicenter for being infected by fear and despair, by hopelessness and denial, both our own and our patients. We are at risk for losing reflective space as we try to contain the uncontainable. Making it work will not be easy, and I believe we will need to reach out to each other, to our communities, for support in new ways. But it is possible, at least I need to believe that and work towards fulfilling that possibility, and I hope you feel the same, that it is possible to make it work. A forced teleanalysis and teletherapy practice, I think, can be made to work in part by making explicit aspects of the context within which we are all operating. We need to understand where we are to understand what we're experiencing. So these are the features of the clinical context I think with as I'm trying to cope with and understand what's going on. First, there was no transition phase. There was almost no time from "we may need to do this" to "the office is now closed." At least for me, it was a mere couple of days between talking with someone about some of the hygiene practices we might need to use in the office, hand washing, wiping down the doorknobs, until I decided that the office was going to be closed. It happened so quickly. Also, there's no choice. Remote treatment has become a necessity due to external events. There was no "let's discuss this." It was more "this is what is happening." There are no exceptions. We've moved our entire practices online in one fell swoop. And there's no difference in the vulnerability, fear, and risk between clinicians and patients. We are facing a traumatic wheel together with the limited tools of telemental health. And finally, specific to us, there are no familiar rituals of collegiality and support. I know for myself, I am missing my monthly lunch meeting with colleagues that has gone on for over 20 years. And having Zoom cocktails with them was pleasant, but it was really a pale substitute. This all happened quickly, without choice or exception, and to everyone. So it's important to keep in mind that your full telehealth practice has nothing to do with personal preference or professional controversies about distance treatment and distance training. This is about caring for our patients, ourselves, families, and communities during a traumatic event. This is not about remote treatment and teaching being better or worse. This is about making it work now because there is no choice. Look, I'm someone who has been and still is a frequent voice on the limitations and risks of remote treatment. Nevertheless, I'm really glad to be here, such as that here is, to talk about making teleanalysis and teletherapy work. Because in the time of COVID-19, what we have to do, no choice, is make it work for ourselves, our patients, and the general public. I have to believe there will be plenty of time later when we can get together again in the same place at the same time for those interesting debates and discussions. Right now, I'm trying to offer what I can to ease the rapid forced transition to a full telehealth practice so we can make it through the long haul of this disaster to the other side. So as we move forward, if you have a particular perspective on remote treatment in the service of making it work, I urge you to actually more leave your controversies at the door, although there's obviously overlap between the two. So that is what I think of as the context for remote treatment. Hopefully it's helpful to kind of make that explicit. Next, we need to understand what makes remote treatment work and what makes it different. Teleanalysis and teletherapy work because communications technologies allow for intimate and immediate relationship experiences to occur across distance. I call these technologically mediated relationship experiences screen relations. And to understand what happens in teleanalysis and teletherapy to make it work, we have to understand the basics of how screen relations work and how they are different from being in person. We are going to start with two concepts for understanding technologically mediated relationship experiences, that is, screen relations. Bear with me. We're going to get a bit into the weeds discussing some complicated and probably unfamiliar ideas. And if they already are familiar, well, I'm really glad you're here. These two concepts are as applicable to Zoom cocktails as they are to committee meetings and treatment. It's about screen relations in general. And by understanding screen relations in general, we're going to be better prepared to understand the clinical consequences. The first is telepresence. Telepresence is what makes screen relations work. How is it that we can sit miles away from someone and because of communications technologies come to feel we are present one to the other? It's psychologically fascinating how this works. We take it for granted. It's part of modern life. It's just the background. But before the early 1800s, with the development of the telegraph, what's been called the Victorian Internet, near instantaneous communication across distance was not possible. Somehow, technologies from the telegraph to telephones to FaceTime and Zoom to emerging VR platforms, somehow they allow us to feel the presence of someone and they us when we are not present. How does this work, and how does it relate to being present in person with each other? What is going on with this presence and this telepresence? How does it work? In her book, Screen Relations, The Limits of Computer-Mediated Psychoanalysis and Psychotherapy, and just as an aside, I think this book is a useful, perhaps even a must-read during this time, Jillian Isaacs-Russell wrote, "People experience presence if they are able to act in an external world where they can successfully transform their intentions into actions." Presence comes from acting in an external world where one can successfully transform intentions into actions. So I'm going to actually try to make this a little bit more experience near. I want you to take your right hand and tap your desk. Go ahead, do it. I mean it. Okay. The sound, the physical sensation on your hand, kinesthetic feedback from movement, maybe the dog startling, provide the feedback of having intentionally acted on the physical world, and that relationship between the intention and the feedback grounds us in feeling present where we are. If you didn't get that feedback, or it happened out of sync, like sometimes happens with VR simulations, or with meeting with someone on phone or video, you'd feel, well, something that's not present. Because the intention feedback loop also works socially. You say hello, and the other person responds somehow. You feel in each other's presence. But like the infants in Tronic's still face experiments, if the social feedback is not there, if there is no sense of being present together, like what happens when you talk, but the other person's screen has frozen so they don't reply. So let's kind of just clarify this. There's an intention, which leads to an action, physical or social. And then if one gets temporally appropriate feedback that intention had been successfully achieved, there's the experience of presence. Presence, actual and tele, results from intentional actions with temporally appropriate feedback that the intention had achieved its goal. So in barest outline, that's how telepresence works. And that's how presence works. And there's a difference between actual presence and telepresence. Actual presence is the feeling, experience of being present where you are and who you're with. Telepresence is the feeling experience of being someplace you are not and with physically absent others. According to the International Society for Presence Research, this telepresence is an illusion of non-mediation in which users of any technology overlook or misconstrue the technology's role in the experience. In other words, the technology becomes fully transparent to its use. You see through the technology to the other person, to the relationship. And it's an illusion of non-mediation because even when we're experiencing that, that mediation is obviously still taking place. Now, this has so far been a description that is heavily weighted in terms of the technological, in terms of the temporally appropriate feedback. But there are also really important psychological variables at play during a successful experience of telepresence. Attention, desire, and imagination are required. Now, this is crucial and important because the clinical consequences, which will be developed later, are that attention, desire, and imagination combine to determine whether someone is experiencing this illusion of non-mediation, that is, the experience of being present with an absent other, or whether they find themselves sitting alone with a piece of technology that might have otherwise afforded such an experience. So when attention, desire, and imagination, for whatever reason, aren't present in the proper ways, telepresence disappears, and two people are no longer experiencing them together. The next feature to really look at is that with screen relations, the limits of relational possibility are set by the limits of maintaining telepresence. For example, I sometimes work all audio, sometimes on screen. I work that out in each situation. One person told me, and I'm paraphrasing, when they want to see me, and if we're on the phone, they feel disconnected. They were not able to successfully express their intention in an external world. They weren't able to see me when they wanted to, and that diminished the experience of telepresence. So obviously, this person and I now meet via video. For someone else, the video feels distracting, making it harder for them to say what they want to say, also diminishing telepresence. So the limits of the relational possibility are set by the limits of maintaining telepresence. Hopefully telepresence is, if not clear, at least minimally good enough useful, because we're going to move forward now to affordances. Affordances. Here's the original definition just for context. The affordances of the environment are what it offers, what it provides or furnishes, either for good or ill. The concept of affordances comes from Gibson's approach to the study of perception, and not from the psychoanalytic or psychotherapy literature. But as I hope we'll see, it's a powerful and useful concept for a clinical sensibility of making it work. One important aspect of affordances is that it lives in the relationship between any specific context, like in office or on screen, and the unique individuals in that context. It's not a possession of either the person nor a specific stimulus feature of the environment. We're going to talk about three main dimensions of affordance difference. But first, I want to acknowledge that the centrality of affordance for telemental health is really tough to grasp and tough to describe, because it's about what's possible, what could be, not what is. But it is central. The affordances of a context, in person or on screen, help organize the meaning and consequence of what people are saying and doing to and with each other, and sets the range of possible experience. When we're in person, thanks to evolution, human development, and each of our unique attachment histories, the affordances of shared embodiment are baked in. Like a fish being able to swim in water, we take those affordances just to be background. When I'm in a room with someone, I intuitively grasp what the context affords me, whether it's a share or rejected smile or a hug or a slap. I intuitively know what's possible. Not so with teleanalysis and teletherapy. There, the unique affordances of technological mediation are hidden, and they will be ignored and missed. Meanings and experiences will be lost if we remain unaware of the unique affordances of what takes place on screen. So, to make affordances as a concept start to come to life, I hope it does, bear with me for an imaginary demonstration. Let's imagine two groups of people are attending this lecture. One group is in person, the other attending via a Zoom meeting. And please excuse my clumsy graphics. I said it's going to be somewhat more refined. Now, I'm going to ask one half of the in-person group to say hello and shake hands. I'm going to ask the other half of the in-person group to wave and say hello, but they are not allowed to shake hands or otherwise touch. Finally, Everybody on Zoom are told to wave to each other and say hello. And of course, there's no touching. Okay, got that? Both the Zoom attendees and the second group of the in-person group of the in-person people did not touch. But that second in-person subgroup were in a context that afforded the possibility of doing so. The Zoom context did not. As a consequence, the in-person context also affords the possibility of a kind of restraint. The Zoom context does not afford that. And the Zoom context affords unique possibilities as well. For example, with your microphone on mute, you can say anything while waving. The Zoom context affords an experience, in that example, of expressing all the hostility one may have while holding without, one may have been holding without any consequence, something the in-person context does not afford. Not touching meant something very different and afforded very different experiences in the two contexts. Context helps determine meaning and range of potential experience. Consider the often referred to example that people are sometimes not able to tell whether the transcript of a session took place in person or online. This should not be surprising. There is significant overlap as well as differences. That's why we can make this forced transition to telehealth work. What is important to note is that because of the different affordances, however, the meanings of the session and the range of experience present in that transcript are different in the two contexts. And if you notice, the transcripts of the second in-person group and the Zoom attendees are the same. You could not tell which is which. While I believe a clinical sensibility of making it work benefits from some attention to those differences, as well as where the context overlap, you'll have to come to your own decisions as we work through the details and eventually the clinical consequences. Because to be clear, what I'm really hoping is for us as a community forced into telehealth to be able to think together about what's happening, what it means, and how we can make it work in this distressing, difficult time. And I believe attention to the differences across the various contexts within which we're seeing people is crucial for that. So let's dive into those differences. The first general dimension of affordance difference is risk potential. The two contexts afford different experiences of danger, and therefore of safety, because the relational consequences of safety in the presence of risk are fundamentally different than the absence of risk. One way to say that is that if there is no possibility of being dropped, then there's no possibility of feeling fully held. One patient in Jillian Isaac Russell's ethnography of remote treatment contained in her book Screen Relations, who moved online, who had her treatment move online, commented on how anemic things felt without the possibility of kissing or kicking. It's not that there was kissing or kicking, it's that the possibility of kissing or kicking enlivened the interaction. You see, when online, there is just not as much skin in the game, to use a pun. As a result, for example, defenses can become harder to see as patients react to diminished risk with some online disinhibition. So if you notice the online emergence of previously defended against themes and topics, it's probably not because of some elevated accuracy in your interpretations, as much as it is a reaction to the attenuated risk the online context affords. The second general dimension of clinically relevant difference, built on understanding telepresence and affordance, is richness or repleteness. Instead of the tsunami of direct experience when being in the presence of someone, all we have is a relative or comparatively narrow channel of information we have to attend to in order to preserve the experience of telepresence. The result is an experiential paleness of being with the other. But we have to make this work, and we can. We just have to be ready for the differences between the tsunami of experience when you're sitting with someone and everywhere You look, there you two of you are together, from focusing on the sound in the speaker or what's taking place on screen. So as we're moving forward, watch out for the way some distance treatment providers have reported uncharacteristic forgetting or uncharacteristic note-taking during sessions to compensate for the relative paleness. Another frequent observation is that online treatments have more frame violations. And this is not surprising, since the sessions and the frame itself, because of a diminished richness to the experience, are less salient and less memorable, and also, because of changes in risk, less consequential. I think of what I'm doing when I'm working online as kind of like driving in a fog. You're still going to be able to get where you go, but it's going to be much more tiring and difficult, requiring a kind of attention not present in bright sunshine. The third general dimension of affordance difference is relational embodiment. There are very different possibilities for bodily experiences and processes when physically co-present than when meeting via screen or speaker. Walking to and entering a room is quite different from clicking on a window or swiping open an app. The physical proximity of greeting and leaving requires different bodily processes than flipping a switch. Some of the attunements and misattunements, as well as body-based preverbal attachments possible with shared embodiment, are absent with screen relations. Familiar and important processes of implicit imitation and empathy are altered when working on screen or speaker. More on this later, but one consequence is that many of the familiar ways your body registered the presence of the other and experienced the body of the other have been turned upside down. We've lost one of the ways we listen. Again, we can make it work. It's just going to be different and more difficult. Okay. Hopefully we now understand the rudiments of what makes remote treatment work and what makes it different, because it's going to be something we apply when we try to support a clinical sensibility of making it work as we turn to the next section. And I actually imagine this is why most people are watching this video to kind of get to this section and hopefully discussing the clinical context, discussing telepresence and affordance is going to really significantly enrich what we're about to talk about. So we're going to work towards a make-it-work clinical sensibility. And we're going to do that by looking at 7 examples of context differences, how clinical processes are changed across the two contexts. And then we're going to be talking about some skills and strategies for remote treatment during the COVID-19 crisis. And those concepts, skills, and strategies will be attending to loss, making difference work for you by attending to risk, richness, and relational embodiment, and some guidelines for building a remote session frame. So let's turn to the first of these. 7 clinical examples in the interest of transparency, I just want to note, since I know what's coming next, I just paused the recording and took a short break. So if you're thinking about when to take a break and you haven't yet, this might be a good time to pause, stretch your legs, or do whatever. Okay, and for those who did take that break, welcome back. Because this is where I want to say welcome to a full-time forced telehealth practice. And start by noting some of the experiences I've been hearing about and having. It's what's going on. It's probably going to be feeling weird. You might be exhausted by the end of the day. You probably won't remember things in the same way. You might feel unmoored and decentered. Patients and people you know really well will feel different. New relational patterns will emerge. You might feel lonely in session. Loss and fear will be avoided or discussed. Did I say you might feel exhausted at the end of the day? You might. Things might even start to go more smoothly with some difficult patients. You might feel physically different, less connected. Your patient's words will take on more power. You might feel more connected to their words, while your body and theirs takes on less. Accuracy will likely diminish. Over the last few weeks, I found myself thinking more often than ever before of saying to someone, if I'm hearing you right. You'll start to have feelings about the technology. The technology will change how you feel about patients. And I am sure lots of other experiences. Do not be surprised by any of this or anything else you may start to notice. One of the reasons we're going to be through APSA launching a series of peer consultation groups is to give people a chance to just talk about these different and unique and experiences. What I want to do here is emphasize that the differences in the context makes sense of this, makes sense of these experiences we're having, and we can make it work by understanding more about how clinical processes are being changed. So before diving into the 7 clinical processes and stepping back for a second, I just want to note that we described the current clinical context, then talked in general about differences between being on screen and in person, and now we're going to narrow things even further by looking at how those general differences play out in specific clinical processes. So, the first one, the facilitating environment and the experience of feeling held. As Winnicott wrote, a facilitating environment provided by the analyst is the setting for good enough therapy. The analyst provides a facilitating and shared external reality so as to be better able to adapt to a patient's shifting needs and experiences. With telehealth, patients have to do a lot of the work to provide their own facilitating environment. They're no longer in our office sitting on our couch or chairs. They're in their home or office or wherever with their technology, with their screen, with their phone. When a patient trades a shared office setting provided by the therapist or analyst for some technologically separate setting that they must provide for themselves, there is consequently a change in the degree and the quality and the possibilities for feeling held. As illustration, I want to give a quick clinical example. Consider a severely traumatized patient reacting to my sharing plans for an upcoming vacation by spending several sessions seething in a mostly silent tantrum. As those sessions ended, she grabbed a large handful of tissues from the box on the side table. She then clutched them tightly on her walk out of the office into the subway before shoving them into her bag. Later, she described how holding the tissues reminded her that her rage and hostility had not killed me, that she really didn't want me dead, that it was a rageful fantasy and we both would survive. The clump of tissues, little pieces of the facilitating environment squeezed in her hand, reminded her that her murderous wishes were inside her mind, not part of external reality. Self and other were seen as different, and she was able to see she had a mind separate from action. I see this as the facilitating environment doing its job. Had there not been a shared external reality, this necessary differentiation might not have taken place, or at least not in the same way. In a remote treatment, there would have been, at best, a sharply narrowed shared outer reality to contrast with inner reality. More significantly, she would have had to be providing her own facilitating environment. She would have been with her technology in her home or office, where she would have had to be holding herself to some degree. We have to be careful not to expect that patients forced into telehealth can now just provide safe settings for themselves, especially like this patient who had never had that basic experience of safety and couldn't even imagine what safety felt like. And providing that safe setting for themselves is more than just helping them set up their technology. As we move forward on screen or phone, and knowing that a facilitating environment for therapeutic growth needs to be experienced, we actually may need to become clinically creative, with patients no longer feeling the requisite safety. For example, with one traumatized patient I see who has been having a hard time with the paleness of remote sessions, she just doesn't feel me present to the same degree, to the point that the suicidal thoughts that brought her to treatment years ago have reemerged. We've agreed she can text me between sessions when she feels the need to do so as a way to compensate for what's lost on screen. 3 weeks in, and this seems to be helping, but we'll see. The point is to be clinically creative by recognizing what the differences are in what people are experiencing. The second clinical process to watch is a new clinical process that emerges online that doesn't take place in the office. So let's continue with the same example, with the tissue example. However much she wanted to leave, she never stormed out of the session. She stayed alone in the presence of the other. But imagine if this had been via screen relations. She would likely have sat lost in rage, wanting me gone, silently staring off into the distance of her home or office, or wherever she happened to be, and that means, poof, no more telepresence. Leaving the session would have been as easy as staring off into her bookshelf or whatever. Remember, it requires attention, desire, and imagination. She would then have simply been sitting angry and alone with a random piece of technology blinking in the background. She would be, in other words, sitting alone in the absence of the other in a session, because with screen relations, making the other disappear is as easy as turning one's head to attend to an external environment not being shared. And because telepresence is driven by desire and attention and imagination meeting the affordances technology provides, when those psychological qualities dissipate, so too does the relational moment. The person is then just simply alone. In contrast, the repleteness of shared embodiment does not afford an experience of an absent other. One can be alone, but only in the presence of the other. Watching out for this new in-session experience of being alone in the absence of the other, whether from distraction, frustration, or regression, corresponding roughly to attention, desire, and imagination, seems to me to be something important for us to put into our toolkits. 3. The therapeutic alliance can become a therapeutic collusion, protecting telepresence by avoiding regressive experiences. One common factor across all schools of psychotherapy and psychoanalysis is a bond based on attunement to the patient's subjective experience. This is obviously true as well in telehealth. On screen or speaker, therapist and patient are constantly trying to read and respond to each other. And we can make that work, to be clear. There is a moment-by-moment adaptation to what the technological mediation affords, with the overarching goal of maintaining the contact. You know, the human rule is, above all else, stay connected. But on screen, that bond becomes as fragile as the telepresence on which it depends. Consequently, and I see this in my own work, that of my colleagues and from supervisees and students, distance treatments often, not always, it's not required, but it often includes a collusion to avoid the dark and dangerous that might put telepresence at risk. And this is not necessarily a bad thing, but shame, lust, rage, horror are often attenuated in the service of keeping relational contact intact. Of course, this does not always work, and when the dark and dangerous does emerge, it can be more jarring and disruptive than what tends to take place with shared embodiment. A tech-mediated therapeutic collusion is actually a useful adaptation to the loss and limits of telepresence. We sometimes work to avoid the sharp anxiety gradients that would put the connection at risk. When regressions and overexpressions of hostility or eroticism or needs for tenderness and affection do take place, they then have different meanings with different relational consequences than with shared embodiment. The next process to watch are intersubjective processes. You know, intersubjectivity is a complicated concept, but it's more than having the mind of the other in mind. It's also the body of the other. Intersubjectivity is more physical than just me having your mind in mind and you having mine in yours. Intersubjectivity is built from bodies being together as well as words and images. Damasio, the neuroscientist who writes about right-brain-to-right-brain communications, says it nicely that the mind is fully embodied, not embrained. John Sletfold's book, The Embodied Analyst, has some beautiful examples about how shared bodily experiences resonate through psychoanalytic processes. So what I find is that in the absence of my body reacting to their body, reacting to my body, and so forth, the range of personal experiences I can access in trying to understand the other is somewhat narrowed, so that I have to work harder to find who they are and what they're feeling. In other words, diminished opportunities for implicit imitation constrains empathy and makes me work a bit harder, sometimes a lot harder, so it's no wonder a full day of telehealth can be so draining. Next, attention, how focused and continuous partial attention replaces free-floating attention and reverie. Attention is mobilized very differently in the different contexts. Telepresence elicits and requires modes of attention that can create conflicts, with familiar modes of analytic listening and attention. And in two ways. First, participants must filter out relationally extraneous distractions in their separate environments that would break the illusion of non-mediation. You have to stay focused on screen or speaker, and this is so even when family life is happening in other parts of the house, when there might be street noises outside, when you're sitting in your apartment with all your things compelling your attention. You have to stay focused on what's on the screen or the speaker. And it's a different kind of attention. Second, the devices themselves compel continuous partial attention, which also must be managed. What I mean by that is, like, even when email, texting, and social media programs are closed, they are still there lurking in the same machine, creating a shadow. So feeling the presence of a technologically mediated other requires attentional work that is unnecessary with physical co-presence, where one encounters an interpersonal field so rich one can only avoid it with tremendous effort. In the process of needing to use, to rely on focused attention, and to deploy continuous, and to fight against continuous partial attention, shared reverie, an open receptivity to self and other that can deepen empathy, can be narrowed. The attentional demands screen relations require narrows the amount of attention we can put on what's going on with our patients. Attempts at shared reverie and screen relations, I've seen, can leave participants feeling alone in the absence of the other. Sixth, technology intrudes as a new uncanny third, both when it works and when it doesn't. When the technology doesn't work, I think we're clear in the way that technology intrudes. When there are pixelizations of the image, when the sound and the picture are out of sync, when the picture is blurry, when the call drops, when there's static on the line, when there's asynchrony between what they're doing, what they're saying, and when you're receiving it. There are lots of ways that technology intrudes in very, very familiar ways, and people experience that in lots of different ways. Patients frequently report that the technological unreliability begins to shade over into the unreliability that they feel that's coming from their analyst or therapist. emotional moments that might have been difficult to construct. Now moments, to use the language of the Boston group, can get lost when the call drops or when the pixelization happens right at the appropriate moment. So we have to watch out for the way that technology can intrude when it doesn't work. But it's also intruding when it does work. And this is a more surprising and subtle point. And it does this because the mediation artifacts technology introduces. And by that, I mean the built-in noises, shapings, additions, distortions, and other artifacts that come from the various technologies that are encoding, transmitting, and then decoding information so that an image or sound can arrive at where it's going. When technologies are operating as designed, they change, and here I'm going to quote Cheryl Branham, who's written some lovely articles about this. They change, quote, the unconscious expressions of human subjectivity, producing impressions that have nothing to do with the subject, yet are often unconsciously confused with them. For example, a background noise is introduced in the transmission process to make the audio sound more normal. So what we're hearing is an artifact put in there by the technology and not the background sounds of the person's breathing, movements, and environment. It's subtle, but it's present. When the purpose of the exchange is transmitting information, technologically mediated communication works as designed with efficiency, clarity, and expediency. However, when the purpose is psychoanalytic or psychotherapeutic relating, that changes because our communications emphasize and are focused on our all too human unconscious and non-conscious inefficiencies, lack of clarities, and inconveniences. What the technology is designed to erase is an important part of what we listen for. The technology does not, you know, the transmission technologies does not know the difference between a person taking an unconscious, very brief pause or a momentary loss of signal, so it just fills that in with other information. As a result, the other we experience is the technologically mediated other, not the full person as they are. There are subtle cues we take to be from the person, but are from the technology. Again, this does not mean we shouldn't be doing this, something's better or worse, it just means it's different. And by paying attention to the difference, we can make it work. Because understanding the presence of mediation artifacts makes understanding the experience of the other just a bit more difficult. And consequently, it should increase the humility we have about who the other is and what they need, feel, and want. The last clinical process I'm going to mention is the way that what we're doing online or on phone and in person are just very, very different ways of being together. So there are changes to the content of implicit relational knowing and to possible moments of meeting. Consider the following clinical example. I'm talking via FaceTime with a patient. A pathologically affable, extremely successful road warrior about his needing to travel so much. At this point, about 90% of treatment is online, as is 90% of his personal and family life. He feels like he's missing out, but he has no choice. Work is work. He especially doesn't like being a cyber dad, but says he appreciates being able to say goodnight to his kids via FaceTime. The session is moving along when he says, "It's weird to be talking to you with the same screen I use with them. Hell, it's also where I work, watch movies, even porn, all here, same damn screen. If I let myself relax, everything blurs together." Something is starting to brew as we move into what the Boston group have called a weird phase, where technique goes out the window and you must directly meet the other. He continues talking about his screen when he interrupts himself to ask me with surprising affective power, "How about you? What about you and your screen? I seem to get what he's talking about, and I feel myself falling into the loneliness of my screen. So I pause, feeling the affective challenge to be present with him in loss, before responding, I feel you need me to understand you by being like you, or maybe to be with you on your side of the screen. You need to see that I also struggle to keep you and us in mind because of all the other ways I use my screen. He says, like with my kids, we pretend. Long pause. But it sucks not being together. I say sometimes both of us pretend our relationship is good enough, but sometimes it's just better than nothing. At least in treatment, we don't need to pretend. We can feel the loss, and both of us do. I'm really surprised by the emotion in my voice. I am feeling the loss of his physical presence, and I am feeling his experience of loss. He responds, but I need to pretend, or I just get too lonely. And he starts to cry. We have met each other. It was a now moment of intersubjective meeting that required us to acknowledge our experience of telepresence as an illusion with limits. We both were able to access feeling alone when together. And we were able to acknowledge we really weren't together, that he's not really putting his kids to bed when on the road, not really reaching out to touch someone because there is no possibility of touch. Our moment of meeting made clear screen relations include loss and illusion, pretense even. Had we missed this moment, as frequently happens, we would have simply reinforced acceptance of technologically mediated pretense. We would have colluded to avoid awareness of limits and loss. Which should be no surprise, I don't think is useful therapeutically. So, we've talked about the 7 examples of context differences by looking at of context differences through changes to clinical process. Now let's turn to developing some concepts, skills, and strategies for remote treatment during COVID-19. The first I'm suggesting is we actually attend to loss. We not shy away from loss. We not hide in the illusion. Because there's lots of loss now. There's loss of our daily routines, social contact, lots of things, being able to shop, being able to see family, being able to visit friends. Social lives have been radically turned on their head. For example, a recent college graduate and recently out of the closet gay man I work with, he's been discovering he's attractive by frequent Grindr hookups, and he can no longer do that, and he feels himself starting to sink into a depression. He misses being able to get that validation. It's a real loss. And patients also have the loss of their physically co-present analyst or therapist. Working with telehealth attenuates some of that loss, but it doesn't erase it. For example, there are also all the rituals around coming to our offices. One patient mentioned the coffee from the cafe on the corner after a session being something that was missed. So I think it's important to attend to these losses and also attend to our own losses, how we feel sitting in our homes or offices, if one is able to get to it still, but sitting there alone, sitting there with technology, not sitting there with people actually coming to see us. By attending to loss, which sounds a little pessimistic, but I think it's more realistic, I think we're able to create and craft an experience of being in this together. Which is how things are going to work. In terms of an actual strategy for conducting oneself during the sessions, I think we need to make difference work for us. I don't think we should avoid directly confronting the differences we've talked about. I frequently find myself talking about differences in risk, differences in richness, differences in relational embodiment. By talking about those affordance differences, although I don't talk about affordances, just more the direct experience, I think we're able to enrich the work going forward. And one of the ways to make it work is to acknowledge the reality that risk, richness, and relational embodiment have changed. In terms of a specific tool, I want to kind of talk about some guidelines for building a remote session frame. You know, I think we're a couple of weeks or 3 weeks into this, so this might be coming a little late, but if there are some useful ideas in there that you want to introduce, I don't think it's necessarily too late. But let me start with a little video of one way that I don't necessarily endorse for setting a remote session frame. You know, there are lots of different ways to do this, and we're about to see one way.
Hello, Jerome.
Oh, hi, are you there? Are you there? You're there.
I'm here, but you are partly there.
Oh,
you once again don't understand where the camera is in your laptop or whatever it is you have at work.
Well, I can see it. What, is this better? Hold on.
There, yes.
Can you see me now?
Yes, I can.
Okay, good.
Yes.
I'm glad that you were able to meet me at this time.
This is the time that we both agreed on. That's okay. Fine. Remember, Jerome, now you only have 3 minutes. It's not the 50-minute sessions. You know, the whole point is that you can actually achieve something during your sessions, which I think was a real struggle for you.
Well, it was, but I have to say that I was getting the impression in the last couple of sessions that I was boring you. And
I'm not bored. I mean, I have enough of an inner intellectual life to keep interested in anything that even you could be saying. All right. Okay. Listen, this is good. It brings me to something I've been wanting to discuss with you. I was really very hopeful when I switched you from the 50-minute in-person sessions to these truncated 3-minute sessions, right, hoping it would prompt you to get to your issues.
Right.
So okay. I hope you enjoyed that. That was from Web Therapy, Lisa Kudrow's hilarious comedy show. I'm really not advocating that we set remote session frames by turning to 3-minute sessions, but things seem to, I think, a little break like that for some entertainment is useful. I do have some guidelines for a remote session frame that I recommend that are currently posted on the APSA website. I'm sure that is too small to read, so I'm going to go through it piece by piece, not to worry. And I developed these with Jillian Isaacs-Russell in a chapter we wrote, Bodies and Screen Relations, Moving Treatment from Wishful Thinking to Informed Decision Making, and that's in the book Innovations in Psychoanalysis. And what we did is we adapted the guidelines that we developed in that chapter for what's taking place here at the time of forced telehealth. So the first piece of this remote session guideline for building a frame is privacy. It acknowledges that privacy was part of the facilitating environment we provided, and now it is something patients have to do for themselves. Hopefully by turning to, by suggesting some of the ways to do that, we're able to help patients find the privacy they need for a session. Now that everyone's working from home and schooling from home, various strategies need to be in place. Not present here. We do mention headphones and entertainment if there are other people present, a white noise machine. I've had several people, and I'm sure others have as well, leave their house and go sit in their car for the session, because sitting in the car with the windows closed is a way to have the requisite privacy they need. I had a couple session last week where the family, the children were a little too intrusive, and we ended up stopping the session after 10 minutes and rescheduling for later in the week when they would be able to work out another arrangement, like by being in their car. That's all part of the clinical creativity I think we have to have in place right now. The next part continues with the theme of the patient now being responsible for their environment. How to make them, how to set things up, how to set up a chair, how to make themselves comfortable. suggesting not to walk around, not to lying on the floor, not lying in bed if they can. Also some suggestions for how to set things up if they're working on the couch. We also suggest to put a box of tissues next to where they'll be. Maybe have a glass of water. Want to make sure that people aren't sitting there having a full meal. Part of this is to try to divide the session apart from the rest of their day. In terms of the box of tissues, I haven't done this during the COVID-19 crisis, but I did have one patient who traveled frequently. And when they did, they took a box of tissues with them from the office. I agreed that they could have, and that was the tissues that they brought with them and when they traveled, and they used those tissues during the sessions. It's important to make sure people dress as though they were meeting in the office. Again, that is a way of creating the special space that we need to do to help create that space for a reflective space. But also, I think it enriches and compensates for the lack of repleteness by putting in an additional channel of information that's marking this as a different time than when they're sitting and being with family or watching TV or doing their work or schooling from home. The next guideline is very, very technical. It's basically turn off all possible distractions. This is an attempt to kind of deal with the attentional load that telehealth requires. Excuse me. You really don't want notifications coming in. You don't want pings. You don't want, you want to create as much distance as possible from someone's attention to Facebook likes and the like as that. So this is a way of trying to do what we can to help patients decrease the attentional load, and hopefully it goes without saying, it's also something we need to do, that when we're conducting a telehealth session, to diminish any technological input that we can other than that which is coming from the patient. One of the things we recommend is to have patients take a 15-minute walk before the session starts and a 15-minute walk after the session ends. If that walk is not possible because of weather, because of physical isolation requirements, or because they're staying inside, to have them either walk around the place they are, or if they can't do that, to do some stretching. This both helps them settle into the session. It divides it up from the bit stream of everything else that's going on. It increases the salience of what's taking place in the session. When someone just clicks from one Zoom meeting directly into what's going on with us, that just increases the attenuated richness of what can take place in the session. Also, afterwards, to begin to deal a little bit with the assaults on memorability, I think it's very useful to encourage people to take a 15-minute break to either walk or stretch to let things settle in. Finally, because one of the features of a therapeutic relationship is its regularity and ritual, I try to suggest that people always meet from the same place during this period of time, although recognizing it's not possible. With all of these, the goal is to make it work. The goal is not to kind of craft some version of best practices. It's to be able to craft something which is going to move the treatment so that it really is good enough. Okay, so those are the remote session guidelines. The URL where you can find them will be at the very, very end of the presentation. So we've contextualized the move, we've understood what makes remote treatment work and what makes them different, and we've hopefully supported a clinical sensibility of making it work. Now we're going to turn to try to ground these informed decisions about remote treatments in hope, for you to ground them in your values and the kind of clinician you want to be. Because the reality is, this too shall end. Eventually. We don't just need to pay attention to getting people into telehealth. We have to attend to getting people out of telehealth. So let's remember not to forget who we were and one day will be again. Way back when we could all be bodies together. This is not as easy as it may seem. There are some powerful processes at play that contribute to forgetting about shared embodiment. So, you know, my advice is forgetting shared embodiment, let's not. But here are the ways, here are the forces, the processes that are kind of pushing us to do it. The first is the, you know, the familiar psychological process of cognitive dissonance. Having worked remotely for weeks, months probably, one then changes one's attitudes in the direction of really valuing it. We always bring our attitudes in the direction of the behaviors that we've actually done. So let's watch out for the operation of cognitive dissonance. There's also the shimmering promise of eventual technology-based reconstruction. I've already encountered technology entrepreneurs who are in the process of viewing COVID-19 not as a traumatic, distressing crisis, but as a tremendous tremendous business opportunity to build market share. Messages are being crafted that if it worked now, it can work forever, and they're going to be presenting these shimmering promises that technology is going to be the answer to whatever it is that ails you. So we need to watch out for the way that the technopreneurs are already gathering to make as much hay out of the COVID-19 crisis as they possibly can. Let me say one more thing about the shimmering promise of tech-based reconstruction. I'm frequently asked whether this or that app is useful, whether something is a good approach or not a good approach. And I think what we need to keep in mind here is that any service that people are providing online now as a technologically based solution to the mental health needs of the COVID-19 crisis, if it doesn't have built in a process for transitioning back to in-person care on the other side, I think that's a red flag for something to watch out for. Okay, features unique to technology. Technology is actually designed to be a trickster. I mean, that's what telepresence is. It's designed to make us forget that being bodies together means something important. We don't want to necessarily allow ourselves to be seduced by the way that technology can be a trickster. Another feature that comes in about unique to the technology is that we're all going to be doing a lot more work online. Well, I think most of us are going to be doing a lot more work online than we ever have before. We're going to get good at it. We're going to develop the procedural knowledge we need so that this just works smoothly. And when procedural knowledge becomes ubiquitous, it provides a degree of comfort that perhaps can make it hard to see what it is that's being lost. So another thing to watch out for is the false comfort of ubiquitous procedural knowledge. There's also the inevitable time lapse of research and scholarship. Things have changed so quickly, and technologies will be developing so quickly, that what we understand never corresponds to what we're actually doing right now. And right now, for the next few months, it's going to be years before people begin to do the studies necessary to understand what actually took place. But we're also psychoanalysts and psychotherapists, and it's not just technology. Forgetting shared embodiment is also powered by our ambivalence about bodies and about being bodies together. As much as I've talked about the difficulties and the challenges of moving to a forced, immediate, full-time telehealth practice, there's also a way in which it allows us to get away from some of the conflicts and difficulties everyone experiences in their ambivalence about being embodied. Judgments and shame are no longer operating in the same way. whether it's judgments and shame about how one looks, what the shape one's in, one's weight or size, how one dresses, how one smells or sounds. Working online lets us hide from that. It makes judgments and shame less powerful. Bodies also have out-of-control experiences that are, one can get some control over when you're not in the room with someone, whether it's gas or passion or rage. Bodies call out and wants us to do its bidding in ways that's can be comfortable to get away from. So avoiding the out-of-control experiences by trying to forget about shadow embodiment is something to pay attention to. And lastly, there's the whole question of fragility and mortality. Right now, I think we're all confronting fragility and mortality because of the virus. Being able to confront fragility and mortality without the direct experience of someone else's body who's experiencing our body might make the confrontation with fragility and mortality just a bit easier to take. So my value is to keep hold of the value of shared embodiment and to recognize that as powerfully committed as I am to making this work and to making forced telehealth into something that works as good as possible for as many people as possible, I also want to keep in mind that on the other side, we're going to be coming out of this and we are once again going to be able to meet each other in person if we choose to do so, and I hope we are able to choose to do so. So let me conclude. We travel with our patients on unique paths towards introspection and self-knowledge, made possible by whatever capacities for intimacy and empathy we and them can manage. That will be true in person or online. Regardless of context, ours is an aspiration of transformative healing and personal freedom through a relationship grounded in a search for personal truth. Unfortunately, and tragically, a part of everyone's personal truth right now is that we're living during a global pandemic. On the one hand, the fragility of bodies in response to a viral invasion and the dangers of shared embodiment means we have to stay at home. Stay 6 feet away. Don't touch your face or anybody else's. Wash your hands. Don't get close to anyone. This has changed everyone's daily life. It's a pandemic of loss as well. And on the other, the clinical hand, shared embodiment has become an impossibility. It is a loss we all share. It is nothing to celebrate. And while being bodies together affords unique and uniquely valuable experiences, both clinically and in our lives, we have a responsibility to make treatments work in the absence of shared embodiment, to make treatment work on screen and speaker. I hope we all take up that challenge. Without the risky, rich experiences and consequences only possible when people are fully present and physically co-present one to another, right now, we have to work harder and learn quickly. And I think we need each other to do that. And I hope this has been of help. At the end of this, I'll have a slide of where you can go for more information and support, including interactive seminars and peer consultation groups where we can continue to think together about the crisis we are all trying to navigate. So thank you for giving me your time. And most important of all,
that's it. Let's roll. Hey, let's be careful out here.